He came over here knowing basically nothing about the game, going through workouts, John and Rick, and really not having a clue.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Backfired, an NBA history podcast about bad teams, bad luck, and bad decisions. My name is Lewis, and this episode is slightly late, but in the spirit of it being NBA draft week, I decided to scrap the original plan that I had for this week and go ahead with a draft-themed episode. So the original topic I had for this week, which is super exciting and under-heralded, in my opinion, I will release that next week. The delay is definitely not because I was sick. I've heard that rumor going around. That is completely untrue. As you can tell, probably by my voice, I did have COVID. My voice is pretty shot, so I had to wait to record until I sounded better. But the central theme of today's episode is a bad decision. And that decision came on draft night in 1998 when Elgin Baylor decided to draft Michael Olowokandi out of the University of the Pacific with the first overall pick. Now, this guy wasn't the worst player in the world. He played 500 games in the NBA, had career averages of about 8 points, 7 rebounds, 1.5 blocks, 44% shooting, you know, lower than you'd want for a center, but he was solid for a little while. It was just the fact that he was the first overall pick that made him disappointing. Olowokandi is the only first overall pick in the 1990s to have a career that was shorter than 10 years. And there were multiple Hall of Fame players in that draft that the Clippers passed on, like Paul Pierce, Dirk Nowitzki, and Vince Carter. And not only is this a bad decision, but the Candyman, as he was known, also had his fair share of bad decisions that he made as well, and some knee problems that hampered him throughout his career. Now, before we get into it, an addendum to 2 weeks ago, the Ty Lawson episode. A child who claims to be Ty Lawson's nephew commented on one of my TikToks and said that Ty is his uncle. I said, oh, that's cool. Hope he's doing well. And big news, he said that he is. So that is good. That TikTok, by the way, is at Backfired NBA Pod. Same handle on Twitter and Instagram, at LogicMaster with a 0 in place of the O is my Twitter. We're almost up to 1 million followers on the show Twitter account, which I'm really excited about. Yeah, please run that up. 998,700 as of recording. So, you know, let's get that to 1 million, folks. Can we do that? Anyway, Michael Olowokandi was a super exciting, enthralling draft prospect back in 1998 because he really had all the physical tools that a late 90s or early 2000s center needed to have. And I'll get into that a little bit later because he came from a pretty unique background. He was born in Lagos, Nigeria, the largest city in the country. And when he was pretty young, his family moved to London. His father was a diplomat. He did something involving military contracting, it sounds like. I actually found his dad on LinkedIn, but there wasn't too much detail on there. So Michael grew up from a young age in London and excelled at a lot of different sports. He played soccer, he did the long jump and triple jump, which for those two, he allegedly set the record length within his age group in Britain. I have no idea how to verify that, so I'm just going to believe it, but he was a super athlete. At age 17 was the first time that he reportedly touched a basketball, and he says that he was inspired by the movie White Men Can't Jump. And that was after he'd grown from 6'2" as a 14-year-old to 6'8" as a 16-year-old. So a 6-inch growth spurt in 2 years, you know, that's pretty good. And then he'd later grow to 7'1", so another 5 inches over 4 years. And his parents took him to the doctor to see if he was growing too fast for his body. And the doctor said, nope, he's all good. Michael was pleasantly surprised to test out his new body and discover that he was still fast and coordinated even after that extended growth spurt. So once he was college aged, he enrolled at Brunel University London as an engineering major, and he did some more track and field stuff. He played rugby, cricket, you know, all your typical British stuff. He tried out for the Thames Valley Tigers, which was a basketball club in the BBL, the British Basketball League, which Toronto Raptors head coach Nick Nurse coached in for a while, but Olowokandi didn't make the team. He still wanted to play basketball though, so he did something that may seem kind of crazy, but it worked out for him. He opened up one of those books of colleges, like the Princeton Review would put out. It's like lists of what colleges are best for pre-med and engineering and what are the party schools and the most liberal and the most conservative schools, all that kind of stuff. And then, you know, just a page for every single U.S. college with a description and tuition costs and contact info, all that stuff. So he's at the library and he grabs one of those and he says, you know what? I'm just going to open this to a random page and call them and see what I have to do to play basketball there. He knows nothing about what schools have good basketball teams, nothing about D1, D2, anything like that. So the first one that he opens up to is the University of the Pacific, which is in Stockton, California, about 45 minutes south of Sacramento. He calls up the athletic department there and he says, hey, I'm 7'1". Can I play basketball there? And the guy who answered just so happened to be an assistant basketball coach covering for the secretary who was out to lunch. So this coach, Tony Markopoulos, he's like, wait, how tall are you? And Olowokandi goes, I'm 7'1". And the coach goes, oh, yeah, you can play here. One problem, we don't have any scholarships left. And Olowokandi is just like, no, you know, that's fine. I'll pay for school. So this coach is just like, yeah, come on over then. Let's get you in here. So they make plans for another call later. And then Olowokandi is like, oh, well, that was pretty easy. Let me try a couple more. So he flips to two more random pages. It's Duke and Georgetown. And the same kind of conversation ensues, but they both mentioned stuff about sending scouts out before he could enroll and all that kind of stuff. So Olowokandi's just like, oh, well, you know, I'll stick with Pacific then. You know, path of least resistance. So then there's a bunch of sorting out, transferring his credits from Brunel to Pacific and working out stuff with NCAA compliance. And they determine that he's got 3 years of eligibility remaining. So he enrolls at Pacific and he's set to arrive in August, but you know, there's no film of him playing or anything like that. So the coaches don't really know what they're getting into when he arrives outside of word of mouth from people more in the know in England who are like, this guy's maybe like a D2 level talent right now. He's super athletic, but he doesn't really know how to play. He's literally never played an organized game of basketball before. So Olowokandi flies from London to San Francisco in August of 1995 and is greeted at the gate by Bob Thomason, the longtime Pacific coach. And he's like, oh man, this guy really is 7'1" and he's super muscular. This is awesome. So they drive back to Pacific. They get him settled on campus. And then the next morning they bring him in to start practicing. And Tony Markopoulos is like, all right, get down on the block and show us what you can do. Olowokandi's just like, I don't know what that means. And, you know, he doesn't know any basketball terminology. He doesn't know defensive schemes, anything. Markopoulos said that they had to stop using the ball for a while just to simplify things to demonstrate to him. But he was super interested in learning and he was really determined. He had a good work ethic. So he came early and stayed late after practice, just kind of piecing everything together step by step. And what was great to the coaching staff was that because he was basically new to the game, he didn't have any bad habits that they needed to break. He was essentially a ball of clay for them to mold into a basketball player. So his journey to becoming the number one overall pick really began right there. And it was quick, but it wasn't easy. Olowokandi later said, quote, I had no idea the transition would be so difficult. I had never played 5-on-5. I'd never defended anybody. I had no idea what help side defense was. You know, when I watched the NBA on TV, I thought everything was improvised. In his first season of college basketball in his sophomore year, it was really rough. He didn't play very much, about 10 minutes per game. He was a good shot blocker, but that was about it. He traveled a lot. He passed the ball into the backcourt a lot. But his junior season was when he started to actually become something. He was able to get on the floor more. He started most of the games that he played in. And this season, Pacific went to the NCAA tournament where they lost to St. Joseph's. But the team was pretty good that year. They went 24-6. And then the next season, Olowokandi's final year, they weren't quite as good as they'd been the year before, but this was an exciting subplot to the season. Pacific started off the 1998 season 7-3, but then they lost 5 in a row to fall below 500. You know, kind of a disappointing start to the year when they'd been good enough to win their conference tournament the previous year. But then they go on this massive run. They win 16 straight games to get them to 23-8. But because they're in the Big West, a weak conference, they don't make the NCAA tournament due to their poor start. As a Memphis Tigers fan, I am inclined to say that a team starting poorly and then turning the season around is a success. But Olowokandi is fantastic this year. And a lot of the credit for this goes to Pete Newell, the former GM of the Lakers, who back in the day, every summer from 1976 to 2008, would host Big Man Camp, which originated when Newell worked with Kermit Washington, who was basically a nobody on the Lakers for a few years and then improved rapidly. Since then, every top NBA center had studied under Newell. Shaq did, Hakeem Olajuwon did, Bill Walton. And it was good use of time for Olowokandi because in his senior year, he put up 22 points per game, 11 rebounds, and almost 3 blocks per game. So he really made a leap and became a force on both ends of the court. NBA scouts are quoted in several articles saying they're super impressed by what he's able to do. He's got a hook shot. He's got a turnaround jumper from 10 feet out. He sets good screens. He blocks shots. And there was talk during his junior season that not only could he make the NBA someday, if he improved even more, he could even move up from being a second rounder to a first rounder. But then during that great senior season in which he won the Big West Conference Player of the Year, the narrative was, okay, he's absolutely a first rounder. It's just a matter of where he's picked. He closed out his college career in an NIT loss to Fresno State with 29 points, 17 rebounds, and 5 blocks with a dozen scouts and general managers in the building. And after the game, his coach, Bob Thomason, told the newspapers that the feedback they're getting is that he'll go anywhere from 4th to 7th in the NBA draft, and certainly he would be the first center taken. So like I mentioned before, some of the people in his draft class are Vince Carter, Antoine Jameson, Paul Pierce, the other two top center prospects, Robert Traylor and Rafe LaFrentz. But as the private workouts commence, the teams that have the best odds to win the first overall pick are slowly dividing themselves into two camps. One camp is teams who would pick Olowokandi first, and the other is those who would pick Mike Bibby. He was the sophomore point guard out of the University of Arizona, and Bibby was basically the opposite of Olowokandi in every way. He was born to play basketball. His father, Henry Bibby, played college basketball at UCLA in the late 60s and early 70s, won 3 straight NCAA championships there, went on to play in the NBA for several years, won a championship with the Knicks in 1973, and then at the time was the head coach of the University of Southern California. Now, Mike Bibby had an NCAA championship of his own. He and Michael Dickerson and Jason Terry and a few other guys, they won the 1997 championship under Lute Olson. The group returned in 1998, lost in the Elite Eight to Utah, and Bibby said, you know what, I'm ready for the league. He was thought to be as NBA ready of a point guard as there was. You know, he was just built for it. He was poised. So the lottery drawing happens, and the Clippers, who had the 3rd best odds to win the first pick, got the pick. They didn't actually win the lottery, but they got the first pick anyway because the Vancouver Grizzlies won the lottery, and the Grizzlies and the Raptors were still under their very restrictive expansion agreement, which stipulated, among other things, that they couldn't win the number 1 overall pick. So that gave the Grizzlies the 2nd pick and the Clippers number 1. And all the early signs pointed to the Clippers going with Bibby. So thinking that they would have a chance here to draft Olowokandi, the Grizzlies are scheming up trades to have on the back burner because they already have their center, who's Bryant Reeves, who's coming off just a monster second half of the season, and his huge contract extension is just about to kick in as well. But Stu Jackson, who's running the show in Vancouver, is potentially interested in bringing Olowokandi into the fold as well because, as he says, quote, how many guys who run a 4.5 40-yard dash, have a 7.8 wingspan, are 7 feet tall, and bench 350 pounds fail? If you go through the history of the draft, very few. Andrew Lang, who was at the time the center for the Milwaukee Bucks, had helped train Olowokandi at Big Man Camp, and he agreed with Jackson's sentiment. He said, quote, he's got some of the quickest feet I've ever seen, and he learns in a hurry. And with that body, he's going to be an all-star for a long, long time. So let's examine the Clippers' situation here. In the 1997 season, the Clippers actually made the playoffs with a losing record, 36-46. They lost in a sweep to the Utah Jazz, but they still made it. And they actually, this is mind-boggling. The Clippers made the playoffs in 92, 93, and 97. They lost in the first round every year, and those were the first times that the Clippers made the playoffs since they were the Buffalo Braves. They didn't make the playoffs from 1976 until 1992, and they relocated twice in that time. That's just insane. So anyway, they fired their coach, Bill Fitch, after they went 17-65 and they would eventually hire the Milwaukee Bucks coach, Chris Ford. So here, in no particular order, are the important incumbent players on the Clippers roster. Rodney Rogers and Lamont Murray, they're both solid forwards. They both started some and came off the bench some. Maurice Taylor, who was mostly a power forward, he was coming off of a pretty good rookie season. He would become a really good player for a few years until he tore his Achilles in 2001. Longtime Clippers shooting guard Eric Pietkowski would return. Lorenzen Wright, RIP, he was a center out of Memphis who the Clippers had drafted 7th overall in 1996, and he was pretty good. He wasn't starter quality, but he was the only incumbent center of note on the roster. They did have another one, but he barely played. And then some of the point guards, the rotation had been Derek Martin and Pooh Richardson and James Robinson. Richardson wouldn't return, but Martin and Robinson would. Derek Martin, who had started most of the games, he was from UCLA. He was a mediocre starting point guard, but a pretty good backup. Unfortunately, he started most of the games for the Clippers. And so as far as the consequential players went, a lot of the returning players were forwards or backups. So there was one big hole at the starting point guard position and then another at center because Lorenzen Wright, like I said, wasn't really starter quality. So Mike Bibby definitely fit on the team. They needed someone organized and consistent and reliable, and Bibby certainly looked like he would be. But the Clippers were also losing a lot of size. Two of their bigs would be leaving under different circumstances. Isaac Austin, Ike was a power forward the Clips had gotten at the trade deadline from the Miami Heat. He had become a really good player after a few years out of the league and was set for a big payday that the Heat couldn't afford. So they traded him to try to get something for him instead of just letting him walk that summer. The Clippers were also likely out of the running for him as well, just because he basically had the pick of the litter that offseason. And then Loy Vaught was another power forward. He would walk to the Detroit Pistons in free agency after a back issue kept him out of all but 10 games in 98. He unfortunately was never the same. He was basically 16-10 for 3 years there with the Clippers. So that's pretty sad. He did earn some money though. He had over $40 million in career earnings. So that's not bad, especially back then. So Olowokandi was also a defensible pick. The Clippers really couldn't go wrong if what they got was the ideal version of either him or Bibby. Up until draft week, things seemed pretty clear cut. Bibby only worked out for the Clippers because he wanted to go number one. He didn't particularly care what team he went to as long as he was drafted first. But then Olowokandi's stock really started to rise. And finally, a couple of days before the draft, he was invited to a second workout with the Clippers, and Elgin Baylor saw improvement skill-wise from the end of the college season to his workouts, saw a good work ethic, intelligence. Olowokandi is supposed to be a super smart guy. He was studying mechanical engineering in England and economics at Pacific. And secretly, Baylor had some doubts that Bibby was going to be a great point guard, like worthy of the number one pick, great. Which, you know, Bibby was never an all-star, but he was pretty good, especially in Sacramento. What Baylor was concerned with about Bibby was his size, his strength, and his explosiveness. So Bibby really wasn't elite in any of those categories. That picture of a super swole Mike Bibby, if you don't know what I'm talking about, just Google swole Mike Bibby. That is not what he looked like when he was coming out of Arizona. He was really small. So Baylor's decision went down to the wire, but he did eventually shake things up from what was expected. Much like last night's draft, kind of diverging from the expected pick at the 11th hour to go with Olowokandi. Last night, I think everybody until about an hour before the draft thought that it would be Jabari Smith to go number one, but it wound up being Paolo Banchero. Same thing happened with Olowokandi and Bibby. Bibby actually broke the news officially to Olowokandi a couple minutes before the draft started. So Olowokandi was going to be a Clipper, but first, the start to his career was delayed for several months thanks to the lockout, which extended from July of 98 to January of 99. Games, of course, that season didn't start until February. They had the condensed 50-game schedule. So Olowokandi actually signed with Virtus Pallacanestro Bologna, which is a basketball team in Italia. And for those not in the know, Bologna is north of Florence in the northern part of Italia. Not quite as far north as, say, Milano, but roughly equal with, Genoa. So anyway, that was so stupid. So Olowokandi's contract with Bologna allows him to opt out of his contract on February 15th if the lockout were to end, and it would end shortly after he signed with them, but they actually were not impressed by him and released him after only three games. You know, he was pretty ineffective in the Italian league. Olowokandi claimed he was just misused. Here's a Sports Illustrated quote. "Usually when you're the top pick, they build a team around you. I'd rather you live and die by me. Don't ask me to be the savior and not give me the chance to be the savior." That gives you a glimpse into his mindset just 3 years after playing his first organized basketball game. But he signs his deal with the Clippers. He had a pretty subpar rookie season for a number one pick, but all things considered, when going from playing against the University of Idaho to playing against the Lakers only a few years after touching a basketball for the first time, he did pretty well. 9 points, 8 rebounds, a block. It's not bad. He earned a starting role. He made second team all rookie. But as soon as the season ended, which the Clippers went 9-41, Olowokandi had surgery on his left knee. Now that's bad, folks. But what's worse is that he then was accused of sexual assault by a fellow Pacific student a few weeks before the draft. She got pregnant and had a child, which they collectively gave up for adoption. I can't find anything else about this case, which is insane to me. There's no follow-up article in the LA Times or anything that, you know, no info about whether he settled or what. Obviously, it's not a criminal charge, but it's very suspect. So, you know, I wish I had some more information, but he was accused of that. His knee issues were mollified after his surgery, and he came back for his second year and was able to get some more playing time. He was, again, a starter for most of the season, 77 out of the 80 games that he played. He still dealt from time to time with knee soreness. The two games that he missed in the 2000 season were due to soreness in his left knee. But, you know, he continued to play. He's playing well. Not what you'd expect from the number one overall pick because his circumstances are so strange. You know, you think of other centers picked number one in the 1990s and they're Shaq and Tim Duncan. You know, I know he's more of a power forward, but they come in the league and they're instant 20-10. Olowokandi is not that guy. But he's still good enough that after his second season, the Clippers opt into the fourth year of his rookie deal. But the Clippers still suck. They're 15-67 in the second year of Olowokandi. They fired Chris Ford midway through his second season of coaching and went with an interim. They would hire Alvin Gentry that offseason. But kind of a troubling progression from the feedback that Olowokandi got in Bologna. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar was an assistant coach for the Clippers in 2000 for a very short time, basically from when the interim head coach Jim Todd was in charge. And Kareem's job was to tutor Michael Olowokandi. But Olowokandi didn't, I guess, fully appreciate the magnitude of what was happening. You know, he's being privately taught by one of the greatest players ever, probably the greatest center. But according to Kareem in a 2011 ESPN piece, he was, quote, talented but uncoachable. Kareem continues, quote, "At practice, I would attempt to point out Mr. Olowokandi's faults to him, ones he constantly repeated that resulted in lost possessions for the team or personal fouls that sent him to the bench. His reaction to my attempts to correct his bad habits was to take my input as a personal insult and embarrassment. He told me point blank that he would not be criticized in front of the team. He stuck to his word and as a result had very few successful moments on the court playing the way he wanted to play." Now, maybe it's just the initial arrogance of being a number one overall pick, because in 2002, a couple of years later, Olowokandi really started to put things together. He put up 11 points and 9 rebounds in his fourth season, which is not spectacular, but he'd cut down on fouling. He was playing more minutes than ever. He was blocking more shots. And he was a big part of why the Clippers were in the playoff hunt. And he really started to become a consistent player. Bill Walton, another great center, publicly declared that Olowokandi was not only turning into a good player, but a leader on the floor. He said, quote, "It's truly a remarkable turnaround. Here's a guy who didn't seem all that interested in playing basketball, much less being a top player. Industriousness and enthusiasm, two cornerstones of John Wooden's pyramid of success, were two traits that I did not associate with Michael Olowokandi." The LA Times noted that if he had put up a year like he had done in his first three seasons, the Clippers would have let him walk in free agency with no hesitation. But his market improvement still never led to the Clippers offering him an extension on his rookie contract. He was eligible for up to about $84 million over 6 years per the LA Times in an extension. But in March of 2002, so right before the end of his fourth season, he said that neither he nor his agent, Bill Duffy, had heard a peep out of Elgin Baylor. And if the Clippers didn't extend him, he would become a restricted free agent that summer and potentially get an offer that the Clippers couldn't match. In public, Baylor said, quote, "He's vital to the future of this franchise. He's getting better all the time. I think he will be one of the top five centers in this league." And this contrast between the public messaging and the private silence really started to rub him the wrong way. At the end of the season, once the playoffs were pretty much out of reach, he criticized the situation that the team had created because there were a couple of other pending free agents whose futures were unknown as well. Olowokandi said, quote, "We didn't play well together. Whenever you have a group of guys that are very uncertain of their futures on the team, that will always happen. Whenever you have that situation, you will never have a basketball team." He goes on to say that everyone was just playing to make themselves look good, you know, playing for the next contract. Quote, "Off the court, we're a close-knit group. But once it comes to getting down to business, finances, everyone goes his own way." He did get fined for that. The next day, he also skipped a team meeting, and he was fined for that as well. The fine has the absolute best description I've ever read on pro sports transactions. It reads, quote, "Fined $50,000 by team for skipping team breakfast because he needed the sleep." The real reason for the fine was speaking out about the individual selfishness that stemmed from players not knowing if they were getting another contract, which Olowokandi called a gag order. And this actually turned into kind of a longer running story. You know, the fine was later rescinded, but things kind of simmered for a bit and then boiled over again once contract negotiations began. The Clippers only had so much money, and there were four Clippers players up for contract extensions that summer. Olowokandi, Elton Brand, Andre Miller, who they had just traded for, and Lamar Odom. But the Clippers kind of dragged their feet on negotiations for all of them, and eventually none of those four players received an extension, while other players of that caliber were getting max contracts from their teams. Elton Brand said, quote, "I can't help but see guys like Baron Davis and Sean Marion, talented players, signing for the max and close to that." And all of those four guys being on their rookie contracts would enter restricted free agency the following summer in 2003, if not inked to an extension before the start of the 2002-03 season. So just a quick refresher on the logistics of restricted free agency. I'm sure a lot of people listening know this, but for anybody who doesn't know all the rules, an unrestricted free agent can sign for any team that they want that has cap space or, you know, in the case of their incumbent team, their bird rights. Restricted free agents have less say in where they go. A team can release a player from restricted free agency by failing to tender a qualifying offer to that player. And a qualifying offer is a one-year contract where the salary is of a variable percentage increase over the player's salary in the final year of the rookie scale deal. And that percentage varies based on the draft position. But if they do tender the qualifying offer, that player can either accept the qualifying offer and become unrestricted the following offseason, or they can get an offer sheet from another team, after which the incumbent team has a short period of time to decide whether to match that offer sheet or not. So for Olowokandi specifically, the Clippers did tender him the qualifying offer, which was 1 year, $6.1 million, instead of offering him the extension that he wanted, which was going to be at least $80 million. Mike Bibby got $80 million from the Sacramento Kings, and Bibby was the number two pick in the 98 draft. So Olowokandi wanted either what Bibby got or more, up to the max, which was believed to be about $100 million. So as a result, his agent, Bill Duffy, told the Clippers, if this isn't resolved by September 18th of 2002, which was way in advance of the October 31st deadline, if it's not resolved by then, we are taking the qualifying offer and we're leaving in unrestricted free agency next year. Olowokandi says, quote, "I don't want to seem unfair by holding the Clippers to that date, but they had all summer to get something done. I hope it gets done. I'd like to be a part of something that started out basically from nothing 5 years ago." But he realized that he could potentially get a ton of money from a different team. So for example, the New York Knicks really wanted him because they hadn't had a great center since moving on from Patrick Ewing. The Nuggets were interested as well, and he would actually have dinner with Nuggets GM Kiki Vandeweghe. So I'm not sure how that's not tampering, but yeah, okay. And again, Olowokandi wasn't great, but he was probably a top 10 center, so he was in demand. Ultimately, the offer that he got from Donald Sterling was around $60 million over 7 years, which Olowokandi declined and signed the qualifying offer, all but guaranteeing that the bridge was burnt and he would be going somewhere else in the summer of 03. So the 02-03 season came, but midway through the season, Olowokandi went under the knife for yet another left knee surgery. He missed a large swath of training camp and a few games in early December with tendonitis in his left knee. And in late January, while he was already missing time due to a bruised thigh, he said, well, you know, might as well get that checked out. So it was an exploratory surgery, but they found some damage and he was originally supposed to miss 4, maybe 6 weeks, but he wound up just missing the remainder of the season because, as he had publicly said before his surgery, he wasn't coming back to LA. After a win over the recently relocated Memphis Grizzlies that snapped a 6-game losing streak, during which Olowokandi was booed, he said, quote, sometimes the fans want to find a scapegoat. I've played here for 5 years. I did publicly state that I wasn't going to be here next year, which I would publicly state again. I won't be here next year. So if they want to boo, they can go right ahead and boo. So Olowokandi had no reason to play anymore. He had 1 foot out the door the entire season because the Clippers weren't going to pony up and pay him the money that he thought he deserved. Which honestly, he did not deserve that money, but he bet on himself by taking the qualifying offer that there would be a big contract out there for him somewhere. But now that he'd had yet another knee surgery, the lush contract offer just wasn't there. In the summer of 2003, Olowokandi agreed to a 3-year deal with the Minnesota Timberwolves. He'd had interest from the Orlando Magic as well, which they actually planned to use an injured player exception that they would get from the Grant Hill injury. But the Magic were denied that exception, so they only had their mid-level exception to offer. The Wolves hoped to re-sign their starting center, Rasho Nesterovic, but he signed a 6-year deal with the San Antonio Spurs. And then as consolation, they were handed Olowokandi because Olowokandi and Nesterovic shared Bill Duffy as an agent. Olowokandi actually had to take a pay cut from his rookie deal qualifying offer and take the mid-level exception from the Wolves. So that wound up being 3 years and about $16.2 million. But going from the Clippers to the 04 Timberwolves was a pretty good move. Olowokandi really was excited to get to learn from Wolves GM Kevin McHale, who of course is one of the great power forwards of all time, one of the greatest post players ever. Unfortunately, all the things that were good about the Timberwolves in 2004 did not involve Olowokandi at all. He suffered from yet another injury. He had tendonitis again, this time in his right knee. So if you're keeping score at home, folks, he had 3 knee surgeries since the start of his NBA career. Olowokandi missed training camp again. He did play 43 games that year and was back in time for the playoffs, but he was ineffective. Only 6.5 points per game, 6 rebounds, 25 starts. Irvin Johnson, the other Irvin Johnson, started at center most games for the Wolves. Kevin Garnett was MVP. You had Latrell Sprewell. Sam Cassell was an awesome team. They made it to the Western Conference Finals where they lost to the Lakers. But that was the last time that the Wolves made the playoffs until 2018 when Jimmy Butler was on the team. The next season, the Wolves went 44-38. Olowokandi again was ineffective. He's just soaking up minutes at this point and getting injured over and over. He was suspended 2 separate times that season. The first was by the Wolves for 2 games for a misdemeanor charge that he picked up. He had refused to leave a bar after closing time on Thanksgiving morning in Indianapolis. So he woke up in an Indianapolis jail cell on the morning of a game against the Pacers. So he was suspended for that game and the next one. Then he was suspended by the league for 4 games for getting in a fight with Nene during a game against the Denver Nuggets. I couldn't find a video, which made me sad. There are a bunch of dead VK links, the Russian social media site. But what happened was that Nene had been elbowing Olowokandi all game. He already had a technical foul. The two were jostling for position under the basket. And Olowokandi pushed Nene. Nene pushed him back. Olowokandi started yelling in his face, pushed him in the face. So Nene punched him in the side of the head, and then they were both thrown out. And that was really the last notable thing that Olowokandi was involved in his career. That was in January of 05. In January of 06, he was traded to the Boston Celtics, where he played a total of 40 games. The Celtics only acquired Olowokandi to get off of Mark Blunt's big contract. Olowokandi was an expiring deal, and the Boston Globe laid out that Olowokandi was only there as kind of like a break glass in case of emergency if Kendrick Perkins or Al Jefferson went down. Doc Rivers, the coach of the Celtics, also the subject of last week's episode, said on acquiring Olowokandi from the Wolves, quote, he's going to help us. When? I don't know. It could be tonight, could be whenever. He was a number one pick and hasn't done what most people thought he would, but I think there's still time. But keeping in mind that at this point, Olowokandi is 31 years old, well past his prime, during which he was injured. That is a very funny statement. Olowokandi was basically through. He did re-sign with the Celtics for one more year that summer on a veteran's minimum, non-guaranteed contract. He didn't get a contract offer until October. There was virtually no interest in him anymore. This was just a prove-it deal, and he did make the roster, but he only played 24 games, rarely played more than about 10 minutes, and his career ended with a whimper when he fractured his left foot during practice in March of 2007. And that was it. No training camp deals that I could find after that. No international basketball, nothing. His career ended the moment that he broke his foot. And it's sad. You know, he seemed to work really hard to get where he was. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar may disagree with that assessment, but to go from a guy who's never played organized basketball to the number one pick in such a short time, that's a testament to how hard he worked, how good the Pacific staff was, certainly. And, you know, not everybody needs to be an all-star. You can just be a player and earn money. Olowokandi certainly made, you know, some good money in his career. He made his mistakes. He missed out on a big payday by betting on himself. I'm sure that he wished that he had signed that 7-year contract Donald Sterling offered, but live and learn. I still think it's fair to call him a bust, but, you know, especially toward the end of his time with the Clippers, he had a year or two that he was a solid NBA player there. I do think it's really interesting how the best players in the 1998 draft, though, were never really under any consideration for being the number one or number two pick. The Grizzlies were enamored with Paul Pierce, I know, but they would never have taken him number two. Sue Jackson just would have traded down if that was who they landed on, but Pierce, Vince Carter, Dirk Nowitzki, of course, none of them ever, you know, were thought to have a shot of being a top two pick based on any reporting that I've seen. But yeah, that's it for this episode. I appreciate you listening. I may make Friday the day that this pod comes out. You know, we'll see how listenership is. This is one of 2 days that usually is pretty good for me to record. If you're listening, reach out and let me know what day you prefer this pod to come out. Doesn't have to be Wednesday. Doesn't have to be Friday. And yeah, may all the top prospects in this year's draft have better careers and better injury luck than the Candyman did. But I think we can all agree, especially Jalen Duren. All right, have a good one.
The Candyman can, 'cause he mixes it with love and makes the world taste good.